What exactly is metadata quality? I think Patricia had some fun pictures about word games and so forth. But I'm not going to have much fun. I'm going to be a little more serious. She mentioned that, among other things, metadata quality is basically comes down to two concepts, completeness and accuracy. You can discuss what's not in the schema that should be in the schema, what kind of metadata we ought to be collecting that we're not. But that's, you know, in the future. That's coming down the road at all of us. So if we just keep our head focused, our eyes focused on what we currently are attempting to collect, and stay with sort of tunnel vision on that, we can speak to the completeness and the accuracy of the data we're capable of depositing now. So this is my interpretation of a range of quality in terms of what metadata is permitted in the schema. And I may have left out a thing here or there. Feel free to jump up and let me know if your favorite piece of metadata is missing from this little chart. But let's kind of go through it from left to right. And the basic metadata goes back to 1999, 2000, when Crossref was started, and the whole mission was about reference linking. And all we wanted for publishers to do was tell us the publication, tell us the author, the first author, the surname of the first author, the year of the publication, the item title, and back in 2000, 2001, the item title wasn't even that important. We were all still doing something called piped queries. I don't know if anyone in the room remembers what a piped query is, but that was the state of the art, and that's how we were doing business back in the beginning. Full publication date is a nice to have, but month and day were nowhere near as important as year, because if we look at some of the most common citation styles that were around at the time, that are still around, most publication date is just mentioned as the year of publication. The page number, the first page number that the article started on in the journal, in those days of everything still being in print, first page was a very important disambiguator, because of the fact that you may have had authors with the same name, published in the same journal, the same volume and issue, and page number became the tiebreaker. And then volume and issue were additional pieces of information that helped cement the deal, if you will, in identifying what was the proper citation being cited if other things were still ambiguous. And elocation ID emerged fairly early on. We called it article number, and that was in lieu of page numbers, because we were all getting online pretty quickly in the early 2000s. So that was basic metadata. And what did it allow us to do? It allowed us to do reference linking. And it allowed members to retrieve the metadata from Crossref, and for them to find a DOI themselves using their own technology, their own search algorithms, their own query algorithms. And that was basically what was going on for the first, say, half a dozen years of Crossref. Then we started getting a little bit more focused and wanted better metadata to improve the matching process. Complete publication info, you know, the title of the publication, the recognized and official abbreviation of the title, the ones that get used by authors when they build citations, ISSNs and ISBNs, all ISSNs. Journals have lots of ISSNs. It's the same title, but titles evolve over time. ISSNs get introduced, but you're really still talking about the same family, the same publication, more or less. Then we asked for the references to be deposited with the article. That is what enabled the cited by service to come into existence. And that was probably 2004. We moved on and started looking for author affiliations and ORCID IDs. And then a big new actor on the scene was funding data. And I think funding data, I'm going to just throw out a date. I'm guessing we were probably 2014 is when we were talking about funding data. And we snuck abstracts in there along the way. And so abstracts are not a piece of metadata that is essential for reference linking or matching, but abstracts were generally considered to be a good idea to improve the robustness of the metadata for other purposes. And about that time is when we really seriously started to think that Crossref's other mission, besides reference linking and matching references, was metadata distribution. And so terms like a metadata hub or a metadata pipeline started to become part of our vernacular, and we spoke about having more complete metadata for other people to consume for other purposes. Those purposes are not necessarily something we want to control, but we want them to be able to do whatever it is they want to do by having more metadata in the system. So then we've now kind of moved into a best category where we want complete funding, which includes the Open Funder Registry IDs of the funders that are being recognized in the metadata that you're depositing. We'd like the award numbers that go with that. Coming down the pike soon on all of us is the idea of registered grant numbers or registered award IDs. You know, making them a more formal construct in the metadata landscape is kind of where we're headed with, you know, the universal world of identifiers. Crossmark I introduced, and actually it may have been introduced earlier in time, but you know, Crossmark is all about providing additional information about the article that's relevant to various readers and consumers of the content, the publication policy, the peer review style, the fact that the article has been updated or changed or modified or even, God forbid, retracted. That information now is part and parcel. It's embedded in the entire piece of metadata that goes with every DOI. And I took a look at Patricia's sample best metadata thing on the wall out there, and I think that's a pretty good one. There's one piece missing, as she said, and Helen, I think, found it. Maybe. So you can see that what we've done is we've evolved the mission, and the metadata has evolved along with it to be far more complete, far more descriptive than that which was necessary to perform the original mission. The original mission, of course, is still very, very important, and we will not lose sight of the fact that we're still all about linking is very important to all of us. So, hopefully, I didn't miss anyone's favorite piece of metadata, but that's kind of my take on the progression of metadata over the years. And going forward with Patricia now, you know, kind of spearheading the focus on metadata and the schema, you know, we'll see new things evolving in this area. So why? You know, there's a lot of good reasons why. You can talk to any member of the staff here and discuss where Crossref metadata goes, what purpose it serves, who are the organizations that consume it, but I'm just going to mention a couple of numbers. So that's the number of cited by links that we have in the system right now. So we've got 800 million cited by relationships in the database. And I'm going to guess that that's out of a total of somewhere around 1.2 billion deposited references. So it's a big number. It's a good number. It can be better than 800 million, but it's taken a good while for us to get to that level. But quality metadata is what's going to make this possible. This is the number of DOI resolutions so far in 2018, and this number has stripped out of it what we know to be crawlers, or what we think to be non-people. So what this number represents, we think, is the number of DOIs that are being clicked on by people. The bigger crawlers who are easy to identify, we try to remove that or filter. That's important data still, and would make this number much bigger. But this is what we think to be actual users who are clicking on DOIs. This only happens because good metadata is part of the ecosystem. So a not so famous person once said, and that's me, so I can make that claim, your metadata goes places, your content never goes. And that is, I think, something you really need to take to heart. A lot of consumers of metadata are not interested in the content. I know that may sound sacrilegious, but it's true. And if the metadata quality is low, you're really obstructing whatever function or purpose they're trying to serve. So your metadata is content all by itself. So this is a chart of 1 week of usage of our REST APIs. And so the REST API, for those of you who don't know, is broken down into three strata. We have the public API, which is available to anyone to come and retrieve metadata. We then take the very same system, and we created this polite sliver. And the polite sliver is intended so people can identify who they are to us. In case there are issues or problems, you know, we have somebody to go talk to about what's going on to try and alleviate the strain and the stress that may be happening. The public API is completely anonymous, and if somebody decided to go crazy or let some, you know, rogue software loose on us, they can wreak havoc on the public API for a little while, and it's hard for us to sort of screen that out. And then we have a third strata, which is the plus strata. Again, basically the same system, but this strata, this sliver, is targeted at what we call MD plus users. These are paying affiliates and others. I'm going to use the wrong words there, and Jennifer Kemp can correct that for sure. But these are people who are given a service level of agreement, and we strive harder to make sure that piece of equipment, that level of service, remain more stable and more available. But this is 1 week worth of usage, and you can see that it totals up to over 62 million hits. That's what Crossref is seeing every week on people retrieving metadata. They're not doing reference linking, they're retrieving metadata. Aside from the REST API, we also have an XML API. And in 2017, the XML API saw 1.5 billion requests for metadata. And in the last 3 months, in the prior 3 months, August, September, and October, you can see what the level of activity is on a per monthly basis. And that's pretty much how it goes month after month after month. You know, there may be a 180 million month, and there may be 110 million month, but it's pretty regular year over year, month in, month out, that that's the kind of traffic that Crossref is seeing for people who are just coming to get metadata. This is not reference linking. So let's talk about completeness. So this is a fuzzy picture. I think it's fuzzy. It's fuzzy to me. It's probably fuzzy to you, but it's not important that you can see the details, because what it represents is something we call participation reports. And I think it's clear enough that you can get the gist of what's being told here. There are a bunch of bar graphs, and they're telling you from 0 to 100 how you're doing. And this interface is open to the public. Anybody can come here. I went to the site, I typed in Hindawi, and I'm looking at, this is Hindawi's chart. And so this is what we are currently doing. This is phase one of participation reports, phase one of hopefully many, where we're trying to give better visualizations of what's going on that let you get a flavor for where the problems will be. The hardest part about metadata quality is finding the problems. And I'm gonna show you some problems in a few slides, and you're gonna see how hard it is to find the problems. And the reason is, there's 100 million DOIs. And you know, if you've got 2% of those DOIs have problems, well, that's 2 million, that's a lot. And finding them is very difficult. And we've, over the years, put together a lot of tools to try and help you find those things. And this is one, this is the most recent tool and probably the most approachable tool that we've put together to try and convey this information. So participation reports, very important to look at it and to keep looking at it and for us to keep progressing it. So I looked around, and the one thing I'll say is that it was shockingly easy for me to find problems. I didn't spend months putting this presentation together. I think I started on Thursday of last week and said, let me go find some things. And so what I found here was a DOI that pointed to an erratum, and nice little update, and I thought, oh, cool. I'll go find the article that's being updated and see if it has a cross mark. And if it doesn't have a cross mark, then I can paint a picture of how beautiful it would be if it had a cross mark and how it would link to the erratum and so on and so forth. But those hopes were dashed very quickly because I couldn't find the DOI for the article. The thing being updated doesn't have a DOI. It's never been deposited. And I tried really hard to find this article. And I used the back door to go into Crossref system to try and find a DOI that matched this thing. So, you know, maybe I missed it, but in any case, here's an example of complete failure of completeness. This is how the rest of the talk is going to go. Okay, actually, this is a little bit of good news. Here's a deposit of a reference that's a good reference. This is a good piece of metadata. This user has given us the journal title. Yes, it's an abbreviation. That's okay. It's a good abbreviation. They've given us the author, a little bit of a problem with the author. They've given us the first initial and the last name of the author. We can work with that, but they're, you know, the quality of this reference just kind of went down a little bit. The volume, the issue, the first page, the year of the publication, and we were able to find the DOI that information refers to, and Crossref inserts the DOI when we find one, and so there it is. But the beautiful thing that was done by this depositor is they also gave us the unstructured citation in its entirety. And you can see there the full author list, okay? You can deduce from that the citation style. That could be very helpful for someone downstream. You see the page range, 25 to 31. You know the size of the article. So there's a lot of information that's buried in that citation. And providing the unstructured citation is, in my book, on the best side of the scale of quality. So let's talk about accuracy. So a lot of concepts at Crossref are a little bit complicated. I'm going to give some leeway on the complication of some of the things that we're trying to do. Yes, it can be a little bit hard to understand. So here's a publisher who decided to do Crossmark, a very noble and very good thing to be doing, because we all know what Crossmark can do for us. It embodies in the metadata additional information about the article, as I already mentioned before. But this publisher doesn't quite get it. They deposited an update in the Crossmark metadata saying that this article updates something, and it updates itself, which is just kind of silly. You know, it's not accomplishing what the intended goal of Crossmark was. You know, B minus for effort, but needs work. So this is the kind of detail that is hard, but not, you know, not rocket science. If you go to this articles and you look at its Crossmark, everything's happy. It's a good, it's, you know, there's no updates, there's no additional information. The Crossmark is relatively straightforward. It is being displayed. I clicked to this display from the article. So they're doing a good job of actually putting the banner on and the button, and everything works. So maybe a B plus for effort. We'll upgrade their score a little bit. This is a problem. We can see that there were multiple authors on this article that were deposited. I'm displaying this in JSON, so it's not XML. But you can see right off the bat, there's something really strange going on here. They've deposited the same ORCID for all of the authors, all right? This is a detail. It's an accuracy detail, but it makes the downstream consumption of this metadata a little bit less profitable. Here's another one, and here we have a little good and a little bad. We have on the top they've deposited the author and the author's ORCID. Very good. In the bottom one, they've deposited the author, given name and surname, and the author's ORCID. Very good. They've also deposited a couple of affiliations for that author. Very, very good. Same ORCID, same person. The very minor demerit that we'll give this publisher is that they've kind of, I don't know what the given name and the surname is for this person. I could go to their ORCID and probably figure it out very nicely, so at least we've got that to work with. But I don't know if O.Francisco is his surname or O is his middle initial. But we've been given enough metadata to work with to figure it out. So this is not bad. Just slightly flawed, I think. Okay, so the last couple of slides are the real eye-catching slides. Here's a DOI. This internal server error was produced when looking at this DOI back in October, and it was produced again when I looked at it on Thursday. And so it's a good DOI. I didn't look at the metadata for it. Can't tell you how good that is, but this is a DOI that leads to a 500 error. So the publisher's platform is doing something. 500 error means something is broken, you know. So it certainly is not a very good representation for this publisher to be putting up a 500 error. And from our point of view, it's a broken link. This is what DOIs are supposed to fix. And so this publisher has got DOIs that don't go anywhere. And that's a really, really bad really bad accuracy problem. They have not updated the URL for this DOI. Here's another one. This is far more common. 500 error is kind of something nasty happened, but a 404 is something we all understand. You know, even most lay people understand what a 404 error is. It just means this thing doesn't exist, but it's got a DOI and it's got metadata associated with it, and if you follow it, this is the page you get when you land on the publisher's site. Now, finding this stuff and giving visualization to these kinds of problems is very tricky. We have an old tool that we've been running for many, many years, which we call the crawler, and it goes out and it tries to sample DOIs and to see if they're still alive. And it has great success with certain publishers, mostly the open access publishers who don't care about getting hit, but it gets blocked by a lot of access walls and so forth. And what it's trying to get to is just the landing page for the DOI. And that's something that there should be no firewall between the public and the landing page of the DOI. This system needs some updating. It's a pretty good attempt at trying to solve the business of crawling, you know, dealing with script and redirects and all the kind of crazy things that go on a publisher's platform. It does a pretty good job, but it needs to be improved. And hopefully we can do it in a way that gives you something to visualize. Because when I look at the data that's behind this, it's just reams and reams and reams of log files and database entries and stuff like that. And it means a lot to somebody like me, but it's not actionable by most of our membership. So that's on the drawing board to be updated. So as I said, it's not rocket science, but it's hard work. Having somebody in your organization that is going to look at this stuff day in, day out, and then having the tools to look at the stuff is absolutely essential. You can't do this by hand. Hopefully, between Patricia and I, we're and the other people that you may talk to today, you've gotten a little more spirited and vigor, and you're going to go home and tackle some of this metadata problems. Don't walk out thinking we've got huge problems. We don't. I think by and large our metadata is really good. I would say, just off the cuff, 80% of our metadata is really pretty good. Little problems like some of the things I mentioned. But I think the other 20% has some real work that excuse me, that we need to do. Oh, and I never filled in my presenter name and presenter title. That would be the template for the presentations. It's another metadata quality at accuracy.
It'll just take me a minute.
I'm Dave Schott from Copyright Clearance Center. So I think some of those spikes on the plus REST service were me. So I wanted to, it's kind of a comment both for the members and for Crossref to think about. I think since, you know, everyone wants good metadata, and I think almost every single company is now suddenly and magically aware that metadata is really important, even though I think almost everyone in this room probably has been convincing their company's metadata is important forever. One thing I think Crossref should think about is that, you know, desiring people to be fixing and changing their metadata can have a pretty significant effect on the service providers that consume those updates. So for instance, I know I saw like a tweet from Jeff that in, I think, July, something like 50% of the 90 million DOIs in the world were updated. I think there needs to be an awareness from Crossref that that also means that for service providers like us, we process 50 million updates in July in addition to every new minted DOI. So I think, you know, like we get at least from our current, you know, our current calls, you know, sometimes up to a million to 12 million updates a week. I think even like automated services like the one you showed that go out, find ORCID IDs and add them to the data, those and update references also can cause automated changes to records, mm-hmm. which then OAI and REST calls see as new records or changed records and show up in those services. So I think while we aspire to kind of increase metadata quality, I think we might want to think about ways that consumers of the metadata can both understand the nature of the change, understand what's changed so that they too can pick and choose what updates they need or want to ingest, and also an awareness that many of those service providers, since Crossref's missions, you know, thin compared to the rest of the world, we also may need to ingest every single one of those records individually from the publishers themselves in order to ingest, for instance, their full text, their subject headings, their keywords, their chemical abstract, you know, all these other things that are metadata that aren't about resolving DOIs. So I think there's just like, it's just kind of a comment and something I don't know if, I think it's less for members to think about, but maybe for Crossref to think about ways to support that so that consumers can get a better understanding of what's changing rather than having to just ingest, you know, everything. Right.
So, you know, there is internal discussion about that very thing. And they're called notifications. We've been talking about it. I'll be honest, it's a project that is struggling to find prominence among all of the other activities. And you're absolutely right. Right now, the pipeline is fairly ignorant of the type of change. Right now, we're changing URLs for Elsevier from HTTP to HTTPS, and we're doing it, we've limited it to 50,000 a day, and it's been running for like 4 months, and it's got probably 4 months to go. But yes, you cannot distinguish that as a minor change from a new DOI. Well, actually you could, but from a you know, a correction of an author name. It's a more complicated problem to solve once you really get into it. But I guess all I can say to warm your heart is that we are talking about it. Any others? Okay. Not sure how we're doing on time.